I'm excited to say the Board of Finance held a workshop meeting last night to develop a grant committee for the town. What we're hoping to do is to get a bunch of like-minded people together that are enthusiastic and energetic, that want to actively research grants and actively pull the town residents as to what their priorities are, what they want to see happen, what they want to see done, so that we can put all of it together, that we have a drawer full of grant projects. So you will be hearing more from us with what we're looking for, you know. So there'll be more to come on that, but I want to put it out there that we are looking to do more in the realm of grants, because they do take a lot of time to research and write, let alone administer once we receive them. I will be happy to give anyone an update on any of the grants listed on the agenda, but there is not much different from last month on any of them. But if you have a specific question on one, I'm happy to answer it.
No, I'm glad. I mean, I think the concept of that grant committee, and I hope it has a good membership and also tries to reach out, because I think it's a problem. Some of these grants come up with very little notice.
Correct.
And then the town throws a lot of effort into going after something, and then it may be that the townspeople are like, well, you're chasing a grant, but we're not even that interested in the thing that the grant is for. And then we should have, you know, if this was a more of a plan, you would have said, there's grants out there all the time, but if the thing that they want to give you money for is not something you want to do, you just don't waste your time and effort.
You almost have to have a draw with projects ready to go, because what we have
a project that are already vetted
that's the goal.
What happens is they give you like 2 weeks' notice to apply for something, and then you wait 6 months to hear back. So that's why you need to have projects already in the hopper to be able to move forward.
And to your point, Bob, we're looking to be more proactive. What does the town want? What does the town need? There is a difference between a need and a want, you know, but if we can pursue grants for various projects that the town is interested in seeing happen, we want to put some effort into that.
Can I add a little bit to that?
Sure.
All of the grants that we've been pursuing up until now have essentially been things where, as Paula said, you see something, you get an email from a legislator, you get an email from one of our congressional representatives, and you have almost no time. And so what's happened as we look around, and of course we've had so much infrastructure that needed stuff, it was easy to find things. But what we were finding is every time we went to a town meeting, people will say, well, what about other things? Like what? Well, what about other things? Okay, tell us. You know, and we actually asked once for input and didn't really get it. So this time we're going to try to create kind of a committee to develop what the operating parameters should be for the committee, and then we're going to hope that committee can recruit a different committee, because we think we need to be involved in the beginning, but we'd really like to sort of turn it loose and let it go live on its own, because it doesn't need to be plugged into finance. We don't need to manage it. If that makes any sense. So it'll be a while, but if you know anybody who has ideas. If we don't have ideas, we can't look for grants. That's all.
Well, I'm glad to get an update on this. I know we talked about this a little bit months ago before we had the, the debates about what to do with our trash contract and the park and rec stuff. So I know this we were talking about this before, so I wasn't sure if this was just something that had gone off the charts, so I'm glad to hear that we're still talking about it.
We're trying to move it from a concept into a reality, and something that's like a future item to a let's do it now. So.
Stay tuned.
Yeah,
before we go on to item 15, is that where we are?
Yeah, if they're done with guest grants, yes. Because then I'm going to roll away from the table, but I'm going to watch in case people need to be admitted.
Well, before that, I'd like to make a motion, or I make a motion to add to the agenda an item before item 15. Labels item 15. Discussion and possible action, eliminate the position of Assistant Director of Parks and Recreation.
Second.
Any other discussion or?
So you vote on the motion to amend the agenda.
Now you have to make the motion to amend first.
We did.
Yeah.
Now you vote on that.
Okay, so unanimous to amend, okay. Now you're making the motion again.
Okay, yeah, I guess.
Okay.
Motion and second, we both for the rest.
And Dana, you're seconding this motion to discussion and act.
Motion to discussion, right?
Okay.
You want to vote on it or just?
Yeah. Do you want to discuss, or do you have any discussion?
Well, no, we're just adding it to the agenda, right?
Well, we already amended. We already amended the agenda. So now this is the actual item.
All right. I brought this up at a previous meeting, and you know, because of what's happened, there are no programs. The assistant director's primary duties were the directors of summer camp and the director before school and after school. And so there's no work for that position currently. So it doesn't make sense to keep paying someone for a position that did not work for.
Is there any key process for that?
No, you want to eliminate the position, correct?
Okay. That's
not a termination. It's an elimination of the position.
Just like the counselors were all laid off because there's
one for them to do. Okay. One will follow the other.
Okay.
Once you eliminate the position.
Okay. Any other comments, questions, or whatever? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Then I will abstain. So it passes with the two selections. So we'll bring the additions on that. And I'm going to, like I said, I'm going to roll away from the table. Are we good now? We can go to your item. Mm-hmm. I'm going to roll away, but I'm going to watch the inbox in case anybody.
So. And then the last special meeting, we received these. It was lucky to get six proposals and six good firms. And I looked through them. Kind of quickly at the last meeting, but I went through them. I have not pulled any references, but in other contexts, I've pulled references. I've never gotten a bad reference that's been provided to you by someone.
I actually called two or three, but didn't get calls back.
Oh, so. Okay. But usually, if you've got any kind of brain at all, if there's somebody who doesn't like you, that doesn't end up in your
reference. Well, I was going to ask questions about. Whether the experience the person had or knows about was related to, you know, top issues we have in town and stuff like that. So they weren't going to get away with just giving, you know, a happy report about anything.
So here's what I came up with. That's in my speech.
Oh, wow. Wow.
And I took into account, I know there was a follow-up email from one of the firm's bridesmen that clarified about mileage and and their schedule.
Yeah, I was happy to see that follow-up because I think we were making assumptions at that last meeting and we weren't.
Well, their proposal didn't mention time, and it did say they would charge for mileage, which is part of their standard thing, but I guess they said they're, and they clarified that they're, although they are out of town, there's out of state, there's at least one investigator is more local.
Right.
But when I came up with it, I have two firms that are at the top, and depending on how I think about it, they flip back and forth. We have Coleman and Conway. The lead investigator is the retired state judge, and he was involved in the Stanford teacher sex abuse of a student investigation and the Bridgeport Diocese sex abuse. He's in charge of their investigation practice. I thought their project and understanding and approach was good. I kind of didn't pay that much of, you know, we asked for the schedule information, but they're all in the 2 to 4 month range. Right. It's going to be whatever it is. I don't think one is really going to do it faster. I did appreciate, they were one of the firms that at least threw out a ballpark estimate of what they were thinking, at least. And, you know, so there it is. And the second is Robinson and Cole. The lead investigator seems to have a really impressive resume in this area with education and sexual misconduct, litigation. So yeah, the price is a little higher though. So those are my two highest. The third one was browsing risk, but really, even though the lead investigator is an attorney, it's a security firm, and they do, it's more of a traditional investigator, and mostly former police officers. But it kind of depends on what we're looking for. I know some of the questions that were being asked were really more legal questions, and we wouldn't necessarily have, you know, a retired police officer answering questions on disclosures and what's proper. Those are my top three.
Can I ask what you thought of Dave Pitney?
I didn't see that much, like, really strong. I mean, it's a big firm, and really their hourly rate was kind of, that was one of the factors for me. They're like twice what the other firms are, even with their discount.
I really liked the Dave Pitney proposal, because first of all, I think they had the shortest turnaround time, and I think that interested me in terms of envisioning getting to a point. And I know you're saying 2 to 4 months for all of them, but their proposal was, I believe, the quickest turnaround time, and I just thought that was appealing to me. And they also, I think they're the only ones, and I think before I say anything, I was really impressed with really all six.
Yeah.
You know, I think these,
they're all fall.
They, yeah, for sure. They, and the proposals were all really good. People, they took the time to read the posting very carefully. Dave Pitney was the only one, though, from what I could tell, that seemed to have already done some work. For example, there's a statement in their packet that says they have read media reports, and I believe it says something like other documents. And I just thought that was, impressive. That they had already done that level of a deeper dive into what's going on here. I also thought that they, just had a really impressive background, and their summary of investigations that they've done. Actually, when we first started with this, with the very first motion that was made to hire an investigator, I talked to a friend of mine who's an attorney in Connecticut, and asked for whether they would be willing to share names of firms or investigators for us to explore. And, he said, oh, you should look at the, whoever didn't know the name of the firm, but said, you should look at whoever did the Cho investigation. So I looked into that, and that's where the woman, the name of the investigator from New York came from, because she was listed as part of that investigation. She didn't respond to our request for letters, but, so I looked at the Dave Pitney proposal provides at least three reports from previous investigations that you can read and look at. And the show one is one of them. And she was listed as someone who had done some part of that investigation, and then the school decided to hire Dave Pitney to do more, you know, after to beyond what she was able to do. So anyway, I just thought it was, you know, interesting to see that they were the ones that that did that investigation. And so I'll tell you my top two were Dave Pitney and Pullman and Conley. I thought I really just the ease. I just, you know, when a report offers, when a submission like this offers reports, and it's very easy, you almost don't have to call references, right? When they're like, look at my work. This is my understanding of the project. Look at the work that we've done. And I think that might be a sign of having an easy relationship and a good working relationship with you know, firms that do that. So I was really impressed with having easy access to past reports. Let me see. Oh, and Pullman, I think they were the only ones who talked about that if we don't already have a litigation hold, that they would, you know, talk to us about implementing that, which I thought was really good, you know, a really good suggestion that they made.
I think when they did get any of the other things, I think they talked about Twardy and his assistant, they're both federal prosecutors, and some of the stuff they talked about investigating. There's one more federal prosecutors. Well, federal prosecutors can have a lot more power and access than they will in this case. So they
right, but there's the reports that they gave us with Choate, that's not a federal, you know.
Okay, well, in his city, I think he says he did that as well, as co-counsel, really serving as a prosecutor. But I just said
it
that way. Not that that takes away, but
right.
You'd be in a little bit different, driver's seat this time if he's working for town of Beth. I mean, it's a separate attorney. So based on what we're talking about, I'm kind of leaning to Pullman and Thomas and first or second choice, and there's going to be like half the price if they fit in. I'm not sure that any of the firms are going to. I'm not sure that Dave Pitney is going to, for that additional amount, is going to give you any more information.
You know.
Here on page 7 under the team.
Mm-hmm.
The first paragraph under that. While serving as a federal prosecutor, Steve served as co-counsel in investigation, prosecution of an alumni affair for the fund and charitable organization.
Mm-hmm. And what is that? Is that the Choate investigation?
Yeah, I mean, unless the supplemental internal investigation is a different investigation, maybe that was the case. Maybe they hired him as a private attorney after he retired.
You know, I think I was really impressed with the Dave Pitney proposal. I thought they were, you know, I thought it could be a quick turnaround time. I was very impressed that they've already and essentially have already started working on this, given their the reading and media reports that they've read in the articles. I think with Pullman and Conley, I do want to be have full disclosure. I, you know, as a lawyer, I have professional relationships with other lawyers. I don't recognize any of the names. I mean, I do recognize some of the names, but not personally in terms of the work that I've done. But I don't, you know, there's no conflict. I just wanted to tell you that I have personal relationships and that they've been on the other side of my cases or worked very closely with one of the partners on a jury trial that I did last year. But his name is not there, and the lawyers that I've worked with in terms of them being on the opposite side of the case, none of them are listed here either.
Yeah, they're both obviously very qualified friends. As I said before, I did not put any weight on the schedule because we're all just throwing something out, and once it's going to say 2 months, but I think Brosnan lists like 45 to 60 days, so it could be 6 weeks. But it's all just going to depend. I mean, if they can't get witnesses to, if witnesses are all lined up and they can all come and, interview them very quickly, but it may be chasing people's schedules and it's going to
stretch. Let me ask you this, though. Assuming, just for the sake of conversation, that Dave Pitney is the best proposal, given that the town has already approved $75,000, I think their fee structure would accommodate that.
I don't know.
I think unless something goes haywire and there's a much larger...
it would have to be a pretty quick investigation at $800 an hour. Otherwise, you just run out of money.
Well, I mean, that could happen with anyone we choose. I just think that I guess what I'm trying to say is that, yeah, I really was impressed with their packet, and I think that that in terms of the their fee structure shouldn't be a reason to disqualify them. Given that the town's already approved the money, and the town, I would think, would want the best candidate to be hired for the job. That's what I would say in terms of, I just feel that they would be, the best in terms of...
I don't think it's bad. I don't think it's better. I mean, the lead investigator for Robinson and Cole really had a very impressive resume.
Absolutely.
You wonder if they're going to be, it also mentions that they're involved in litigation around the country. You wonder how much focus you're going to get. Impressive resume, both their children's groups and involved in policymaking. That all sounded perfect, but I don't know if they're going to be just overseeing it or really being all the group. It's not that they're there, but I mean, really, I don't think their 2 months means anything to somebody else's 3 or 4. I think they're all going to accomplish it in the same amount of time because you're definitely going to, I mean, if these, if these other two that gave us ballparks at $65,000 and they were going to charge $375 an hour, and the ones that were $400 to $220 an hour, it's going to be $53,000.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to $800 and $600 an hour, you're going to be over your $75, assuming they use the same number.
Right, but if you've already started the investigation before you've even been hired, that's a really strong indication that you're committed and that you will be working in a time frame that's probably quicker than some others. I mean, I just was really, really impressed by that. So tell me, I mean, we don't have to have this meeting for hours and hours. I mean, if you feel that, you're
worried about.
Okay.
And then whichever firm we decide to go with, they're going to want to submit a, engagement letter and agreement, right? Mm-hmm. And then we're going to have to see what that is, and we'll have to make sure we're inserting there that they cannot, exceed $75,000 for a written authorization.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of doesn't help us, but the issue will be if they're going along and they're like, okay, we're about half done and we're stopping work. And we have to go to the finance board and town meeting.
I think that some of these proposals mentioned keeping us informed and all of that. So I'm not worried about that. I mean,
no, just add more delay to the report to people that if you have to stop.
Exactly, and that's part of the reason why I like Dave Pitney for their proactive response, jumping in, reading things they didn't have to read to submit a proposal, and sort of beginning the work, essentially. Maybe I should worry about the timeline and the $75,000.
Because it's if they run out, it's going to, everything's going to have to stop.
Right.
Um, because there is no guarantee that the townspeople will approve another 75 or whatever.
Right.
It might just say, you know, based on what we've seen so far, you're not really going to provide any more information than we have, mm-hmm. and just, you know what I mean? And so it'll just end or something like that.
Well, we can be optimistic and hope that it could get done, you know, within within the guidelines we have so far. So do you, again, I think all six are good. I feel like as a town, we're very fortunate that we got a good response, you know, and, you know, when I say, you know, that I would go with Dave Pitney, I'm not, you know, at all saying anything, I don't even, you know, about the others. I just, again, feel very fortunate that we have these options, and I think Dave Pitney is the best. I think that I would want to advocate for the best of the town. But I mean, I had as my top choices Pullman and Connolly and Dave Pitney. So I mean,
I'm suggesting Pullman and Connolly. I'm worried about the price. I'm not saying that they're bad.
No, I'm not saying any of them are bad either. And so it's, you know, it was difficult sort of going through and, you know, reading the reports, making calls, and just feeling like all six of them were very good, you know. So it looks like I'm not going to be able to convince you to go with Dave Pitney, even though they could be, the cost we don't really know. They could end up being, if they've already started, it's possible that they could cost us less than the other firms. It's an unknown. So,
Pullman and Connolly with their $300 and $400 an hour, they could just put more hours in.
Right, absolutely.
They double the hours.
Absolutely.
So it's easy to do. One of the things I mentioned was we're on page, Pullman and Connolly, page 2 to 3, project understanding and approach. They've got itemized A through I. And what I liked about it was some of the other ones kind of cut and paste what we gave them.
Yeah.
And this is not what we gave them. They read through it and they synthesized it. So like we understand what they, so when they put it at least into their own words, like we kind of understand what they're looking for and mm-hmm. like that, which required some thought about it rather than just printing out your resume and then some of them just basically regurgitated what we gave them and like, we're gonna give you what you asked for.
Reading,
you think that they must have gotten together and thought about what is this town asking for, what do they need?
Right. Yeah. That
was what was impressive to me.
Dave Pitney also has a really good statement about their understanding of the project. I think that when you read the reports, actually I got this from both Pullman and Connolly and Dave Pitney, when you read some of the previous reports that they've written, one thing that that I liked and learned about reading them is that, you know, I speak for myself, I guess, I'm the minority, but I would say I think we're not looking for an investigator to tell us what we want to hear, right? We're looking for an investigation that would tell us what happened and give us that information. And reading these reports, it became very clear that the writers are not writing a report that they think the people that hired them want to hear. They're, sometimes very strongly just providing the facts. So, you know, I don't know. I don't think we need to really, I don't know. Again, I would say, that I personally would go with Dave Pitney if I were my decision. So I don't know if you feel that because of that, for the doubt, you know, their fee structure, if you think that's disqualifying, then I don't think I'm going to be able to convince you otherwise.
Yeah, and with the project understanding and approach, I think they basically just threw the same language back.
No.
Which is fine, but it didn't show as much. A lot about it. Now, where did you say that they put in that they had done research? Okay, here on your schedule, based on information currently available.
It was on page 5 at the very beginning that they said they reviewed various media reports and articles. I think that when they said that the town is interested in the community's call for answers, transparency, and accountability, I think that's exactly right.
Where is it?
It's sort of at the top of page 5. It's the second, in addition, paragraph.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
We've also used various media reports and articles. I mean, that's not really why. If you Google it, you're going
to... No, I'm just saying they did it. I mean, it takes time to read articles and, you know, listen to, yeah. You know. And then at the end of that little paragraph, I think that they really... it's a good summary about what we're doing here.
I just think it's your expensive. And basically, the attorney's charged 30 hours, so unless they can run twice as fast as the other firms, they're going to be.
Well, not twice as fast.
$791 is slightly less than price 400.
So what do you want to do?
If they're expensive, so who would you go with next?
As I said earlier, Dave Pitney and Pullman and Conley were my top two.
Okay. And I said Pullman, Conley, and Robinson and Cole go back and forth depending on, you know, which how much I read it. Definitely, if somebody said, who's the most qualified lead investigator, I'd go with Robinson and Cole. But I don't, you know, I don't know whether you're just getting how much you're getting for working on it. And it's in terms of the associates and that we'll be working on it, then we'll be putting in really more of the time. I don't know that any one firm has better associates versus another.
They would disagree with
that. I'm sure. Yeah.
I think
maybe to come to a consensus, we try with Pullman and Conley, then now we have to get it. And then maybe you can help us here. How do you see the mechanics of this working?
Well, this needs to be a motion. It needs to be seconded.
That much I knew.
We know that.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, once we leave here, how do we get an agreement? Who's going
to
sign it on behalf of
either,
the town?
Either one of you can take the lead, or you can ask me to reach out to them and for them to present a retainer agreement. And then that would be presented to you at your next meeting, or unless you want to have a special meeting.
I don't, but if that's going to save a month, I guess.
Do either of you have any objection to my calling them? No. Okay, thank you.
Well, you could have a special meeting via Zoom. You don't necessarily have to have it in person if you're just approving it with you.
I don't mind coming here for meetings.
Yeah, I mean,
if it's scheduled,
it should be 8 in the morning thing, or whatever the family has been in. Yeah, we're just a quick nothing else. Just, and it'll be sent to both ahead of time. But yeah, please convey to them that the town's only approved $75,000, so that has to be part of the agreement that we doesn't just go over that without letting us know, hopefully in advance. And hopefully not at all, since they ballparked less than that.
I think that's what did it for me.
Well, I did appreciate that they did it. And I was like, well, how come only two of them did what we asked? But I think in the final draft, we did not put that.
Right. I think that's right. I'm happy to convey that. I actually think that all of the submissions had similar time frames. And I think that is a recognition that this isn't an investigation that should take forever. And so I'm hoping that being under that 75,000 is a reasonable request.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a lot of the stuff they may be asking the town for information and emails and things. It really depends on how quickly they can get that information and how quickly they can schedule and complete the interviews, right?
Right.
With town employees, it's probably going to be easy if they're trying to contact former Park and Rec employees and they're off at college or something.
Right.
It may take a little more time, but of course they can do telephone and other things.
Zoom.
Other, but there may be some individuals that really in person is, if they're trying to determine credibility and stuff, in person is better than. All right. Do you make the motion? To select a firm and request a retainer agreement.
A motion to select Pullman and Conley and for me to reach out to them and to request a draft retainer agreement.
So moved.
Vote.
She moved your second.
Oh, I sent them again. All in favor? Aye. Did you vote aye?
Yes, okay. Yes, I did.
Then I don't think there's anything else for us to do tonight on that item, right?
I'm sorry, I meant to add, I'm so sorry.
Well, we haven't adjourned yet.
Right, okay. I meant to do it so we could bring it. You know, I was wondering if I'd like to make a motion to add an item to the agenda to allow Mr. Friedman to comment on the sustainable Bethany, the committee, is that what it was called? Recycle committee. It's been so long that I can't even remember. So that's
making a motion.
My motion.
To amend again.
Yeah. To amend the agenda to add. Okay. To add, yeah. To add.
Second.
And that's to amend. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. And then the item is to allow Mr. Freeman to
talk about the solid waste and recycling.
I mean, you're making that motion to the and Bob.
Okay. Yeah, can we do that? Yeah.
Well, no, we amended now. We're allowing him to.
Okay. So this came up on the Board of Selectmen meetings on September 6th, June 4th, to create or reactivate the solid waste committee.
Mm-hmm.
It was put on hold until the recycle center was handled. That was handled in June. So there's a whole bunch of data which is available, both from at the recycle center and finance, which they gratefully provided to me. Members of Sustainable Bethany and others in the community went through this data, did a deep dive, and here's what we find. Our residents are making a lot of effort to go to the recycle center and separate the recyclables. On average, about 1,000 cars a week go to the recycle center, which is half household every week. We are paying more for commingled plastic than if we just threw it away. We are paying more for paper than if we just threw it away. We are getting nothing or close to nothing for cardboard and scrap metal, even though they have a lot of value. We are getting nothing for glass, even though it has retail value. We do not have a contract with the group that services the recycle center. And they set the prices that we pay, and we pay them. For both commingled and paper, they've been increasing 10% per year, even though that's not what the market is demanding. Observations that have been made is approximately a third of the vehicles that go to the recycle center don't have a residence sticker. They may be residents, but they don't have a sticker shown. Prior to 2016, when we were getting paid for our recyclables, it made sense to let them do it because we would get paid for it. Now it makes no sense. We're paying for somebody else's recyclables. The attendants are supposed to be collecting payments for tires and freon containing appliances and give that money to the finance department. But if you look at the revenues that we've gotten in versus how much we spent for that, there's a big gap. So we're not actually collecting all the money that we should be collecting. This is something the town needs to address. I propose two immediate actions. The first is to generate a proposal for vendors who want to service the recycle center and put that out to bid. Doing a handshake agreement is not sufficient. Second, we should form a solid waste and recycle committee that has the goal and responsibility to develop strategic and tactical planning on the town's waste handling processes, a plan which is both financially and environmentally responsible. I also propose that we don't do anything until we have that strategic plan in place. Thank you.
Thank you.
So would you be willing to be on the committee if it were formed?
If the goal is to develop a strategic plan, mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. All right. We'll keep that in mind. And I think I'm going to have to look. If it's not, I think I've had something on solid waste in the past, which probably needs some updating, which would like to help me look into that and do updating on that as well. Okay.
Updating what?
The town code has there's something in there on solid waste management and stuff in the town code, and the town
I think it's still from when we were trying to control where private haulers went.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so is it older, a little older?
We do have the town code mm-hmm. review committee, so that's I'm sure going to be on the list for
the year. We've gotten in trouble with the Superfund sites, so because people would pick up trash and started the Beacon Falls and Naugatuck, and we had to pay for the in terms of those settlements in those cases. So I think that then the town was trying to the ordinances, but we don't enforce that as far as I know. People will have to come in and get permission on where they took the trash out of town. So as I said, the ordinance all talks about all this. You have to come to town and we tell you where you take your trash, but nobody does it. Yeah, definitely needs to be up.
Conversation with some of the organizations like CCM, FOSS, and that, the town, the state looking into how do they manage all the haulers and things like that, having them registered and that kind of stuff. So, that is a hot topic.
It used to be.
It still is.
So, I don't see a downside. I actually, as a town resident, am really appalled to hear about some of the stuff that's happening. And I think most people probably don't know about the inefficiencies, the environmental issues, the lack of, follow through with what we should be doing in terms of, collecting those fees. I don't see a downside, unless I'm missing something. I don't see a downside in having a committee absolutely. Like this.
No, I'm saying the committee does need to be reactivated.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that because I think I tried to talk about this in January, February, and you weren't in support of it. So I'm glad.
I think at that point we were waiting to see what happened with the town budget and the recycling and that kind of stuff. That's why we were holding on to see what avenue it was going to take with approval with the town budget. But if we were going to do it single stream, if that was any part
right,
of
right. And I remember that was sort of your excuse at the time. But again, there is no drawback to having a committee talk to us about, doing this research that in part has already been done and talking to us about good practices for a town for the environment. I just don't see even in hindsight, why we have this huge delay. So, I mean, I would move to have the committee established.
I will look at the past to see how many people were on the committee at the town. No.
Yeah, that's what you said in January.
No,
do you want to second my motion to have this committee?
We need to appoint people, but.
The reason why I'm trying to make a motion is that this has been discussed since at least January, and I've only been on this board since December. And there's been a lot of delay. I don't understand the delay. I don't see any downside at all in having a commission talk to us about.
I want to double check the town code to see if there's a set number of members to it. That kind of thing, so that we can post for it and people can, just like I did with the other board and commissions.
So if you feel it's necessary to have a motion.
I do feel it's necessary.
That's fine.
Because I've been hearing this.
I thought it was just a consensus, but either way.
Right. So, but without a motion, nothing's going to happen because this is what we talked about in January.
Okay,
and I feel like I want to apologize because this was on my radar and then other things in town got me thinking about other things, but this is important, right? It's important. And I just don't see, I think it's a great benefit to the town. And we're lucky that people in town know a lot about environmental issues.
So you make a motion, you second it.
Yeah.
And to reestablish the solid waste.
Seek members.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So how soon can something go out?
I'll start tomorrow morning. When I come in, I will start to research it. If there are any requirements, you know, in the town code as far as number of people that can be on it, see what it has. Because, like I said, I think that town code needs to be, as do a lot of the town codes, need to be updated. Which we've been working on. That's why I established the town code review committee.
When's the next bulletin coming out? Because I'm thinking that would be
the October one just came out. So would not be till the end of October.
Okay. So in that,
but we can certainly post it on Facebook. We can post it on the town website.
Okay.
We can get word out somehow with regard to
that would be great. And so in the bulletin also, people who are on Facebook,
absolutely.
Because I'm not on Facebook a lot, and sometimes I hear stuff, and it's just So it'll be on the town Facebook page.
We'll put it on the town website, the Facebook town Facebook page, and then obviously depending on the response, we'll continue to also put it into the next bulletin issue.
Okay.
And maybe at that point, Eric, you can give me a little write up to go along with it. He's nodding yes back there, so we can.
Oh, great! That's great.
Yeah. So we can have the parameters of the committee and stuff. So, Eric, I'm in tomorrow morning if you want to touch base with me. Okay.
Thank you.
So not on the agenda, so I'm not going to ask for any action. I just, we got these letters about wetlands.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about that at a future meeting.
I think Don is working with Lena on that a bit, and Lynn was here, unfortunately, he left. So I think he's following up with Chris Sullivan on that. So I don't have any other information.
Could that be on the agenda for next meeting?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep.
Even if it's just a report, then it's always out.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Absolutely.
And then being able to send something today by email, maybe it's for future, something about what kind of ID is for discontinuance of those votes that through.
Oh, I have those for signature here.
Oh, okay,
those don't require action. Those were approved at the town meeting. They just require signature.
I was just asking what if anything we're supposed to do.
Yeah, no, I have those, so those just require signature.
Okay.
So those don't need any action at all.
I don't think we're ready for items. I think
it might be 17 or 18 at this point. I have to check my numbers, but most of you would turn.
Second.
Thank you everyone for attending.
Road in opposition. Exhibit 13, we have a letter from Judith Sulkis of 70 Ann Drive in opposition. Exhibit 14, we have a letter from Philip and Adele Fama of 95 Luke Hill Road and Jeff and Pam Rubelman of 7 Robertson Drive in opposition. We have a letter from Eric and Kyoko Tischer of 344 Sperry Road with questions regarding the application. We have a letter from Lisa Anderson of 62 Wooding Hill Road in support. And we have 178 blue postcards with 305 signatures regarding the proposed zoning change that are in opposition to the applicant's proposal. And then finally, number 20, we have a letter which was received tonight from the Bethany Volunteer Fire Department, which expresses concerns and makes suggested changes to the regulation if it were to be adopted by the Planning and Zoning Commission. So that's the public record that we have for the application. In the file, we also do have a copy of the check covering the fees for the application. We have the application form itself. We have all of the letters of notification that Planning and Zoning is required to send out to ensure that the adjacent towns and the proper agencies have been notified, and those are all also part of the public record. And so there ends the boring part of this hearing, and we will now hear from the applicant. Thanks.
Thank you very much. My name is Jack Nork, and I'm a member of Greenhaven. My wife, Allie, and I and our three boys live on Beacon Road. My wife and I moved to Bethany in 1998, and I love Bethany and have been very active in making the town the best it can be, with things such as founding the robotics program at the community school and the Lakeview Lodge concert series, which many of you enjoy. I also serve on local boards. I currently serve on the AMNI Teen Center Board of Directors and formerly served on the board for the Bethany Land Trust. A few years ago, Allie and I heard about a few people who were looking into the idea of what's called co-housing, creating a small pedestrian-based neighborhood of homes specifically designed so as to live more lightly on the land. As we learned more about it, we became involved in the planning ourselves. Co-housing is about creating a neighborhood on purpose by the same people who are going to live there, so we can make the kind of decisions for sustainability and planning process that a commercial developer just would not or could not do. But none of us have experience with planning and building, and we all have our work and our busy daily lives. So our group very soon realized that however competent we were at our professional careers, we're amateurs when it comes to putting together a new neighborhood. So we asked around to see who could help us. One of the first people we contacted was Leslie Higgins Biddle, who lives in Bethany. She recommended that we find a housing consultant to help us make this happen. And one of the people she named was David Berto, who has been guiding us through this complicated process ever since. We also knew we needed a land use attorney, and David led us to John Parisi. David will speak a little later. Right now, I'd like to turn the floor over to John, who will introduce the proposed open space housing district that we're here to talk about tonight.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, Madam Chair, members of the commission. My name is John Parisi. I'm an attorney, and I practice with the firm of Perrette, Porto, Parisi, and Caldwell in Hamden. My client this evening is Greenhaven, Inc. Greenhaven is a non-stock corporation comprised of a diverse group of individuals from the area, including several from Bethany. Greenhaven is here because they want to develop a property that they and their families can live in. My client has embarked on this long regulatory journey because its members aspire to develop the property on Myers Road so that they and their families can live there. Greenhaven currently holds an option to purchase the property at 4 and 21 Myers Road. The current owner, Halter Estates Senior Community, is the party that brought the affordable housing application, which this commission rejected, but was later ordered to approve. Greenhaven proposes to replace the court-ordered approval of 48 units with its own plan to develop between 25 and 35 units of co-housing.
Good evening. My name is Brenda Caldwell. I've lived in Bethany since 1994, almost 20 years. I've been a corporate paralegal, a teacher at Beecher Road School in Woodbridge, and now I manage an organic farm in Cheshire. My daughter went to Bethany Community School and to Amity. I was one of the original members of Greenhaven Co-Housing and was part of the site selection committee. We've always had the goal of finding land that we can farm. The Myers Road property is the perfect place, close to many people's workplaces, with tremendous potential for growing food for our 3 or 4 weekly community meals in our individual kitchens. Veggies, fruit, berries, nuts, and eggs. What an incredible privilege it would be to bring the Myers Road land back to the way it was when Elsie Halter produced her award-winning milk with 30 cows. Or earlier, when the Meyer family sold vegetables and eggs at Rocky Corner Farm.
I also want to make sure that, for the record, that those in attendance tonight are Melissa Spear, Mary Shirtleff, Commissioner, Patricia Weiner, Commissioner, Michael Calhoun, Commissioner, Kimberly McClure, Commissioner, Nellie Rabinowitz, alternate to the Commission, and Donna Shea, alternate to the Commission, as well as our clerk, Tony Merrick, our CEO, Isabel Kearns, and our town planner, Hiram Peck. Tonight, I do ask again that if you could, those of you who are going to comment and speak, if you could limit your comments to as brief as possible, maximum 2 to 3 minutes, so that we can try and get through everyone. There are a large number of people who are signed up to speak, whether they're all here tonight or not, I'm not sure. We will see. It would be nice if we could try to end around 10 o'clock tonight, so that we can all make sure we get our sleep. And again, I thank you all for coming, and I'm gonna first turn this over to Mr. McSherry.
Point of order. I'm sorry, you don't get to do that. The format and the ground rules for the way this hearing was supposed to be conducted or presented and laid out, I think you did it at the last meeting.
That was first.
And that's where we are. We're continuing this public hearing, and what's happening right now is the public is being allowed to speak. That's why it's called a continuation.
We are going to follow the procedure that I just laid out. The procedure I laid out in the last hearing was for the last hearing.
No, this is a continuation. You don't get to do that. Stand up. Make them know.
You're right.
Stand up. I live at 79 Myers Road. I would like to begin by submitting this map as an exhibit showing all the properties in town that this proposed zoning change would affect. There are 45 of them, totaling nearly 2,000 acres. Everyone in this room has one of these parcels near them. If passed, this would be a windfall for developers. For as long as the land holds out, Bethany would be the development capital of Connecticut. The moral high ground here is held not by a developer, but by the townspeople supporting the original, unchanged zoning regulations. These have, for more than 60 years, successfully protected the land, the water, and our rural heritage.